Now we have DevDAS talking about lies, damn lies, statistics, and benchmarks.
An alternative title for my talk would have been, "What numbers do you want to buy today?" So, most people, a third one that I actually considered is, you can't get much higher. So, this is literally a statistical thingy here. Yeah, it's 18,300, whatever, blah, 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 and it claims to be the world's highest motorable road. This is actually a good statistic. It's measurable. And if you're being involved in most companies like I have, you end up with this situation where we say, okay, I want to buy some new hardware. And the first reaction is this value for money? And how long is this going to last me for? So obviously you want to do some benchmarking. You want to figure out metrics and say, right, this is probably the best I can get for this much money, and then I'll make that decision. So you run a bunch of tests and more tests and more tests, and then you say, okay, so this is the best thing I can get. Then you actually buy it and you realize that, you know what, this product sucks. Mostly because we didn't know what numbers we were looking at. So I got a bunch of anecdotes about people at my organization who have made classic mistakes with statistics. I don't claim to be an expert. I just know that at times you're going to have really bad data coming through because the person doing the measurements didn't know what they were doing. The straightforward problem that we have is that we really can't make sense of large numbers, of numbers itself. If you are given a record set of a million numbers, you're not going to think about it. It's too big. It doesn't fit on a single screen. It's too big to deal with. We need some way to summarize the problem. Humans didn't evolve to deal with large numbers of numbers. That's not a bug. That's a very good feature. It keeps you alive at times, and it helps summarize. We know statistics. Everybody knows statistics, right? Somebody who doesn't know? Okay. Everybody seems to know statistics. Statistics are pretty much useful, and they are one of the most hardest to understand, at least as far as I'm concerned, number crunching bits. So it says, okay, here's a bunch of set of numbers, describe this set to me. And you do some statistical stuff and it out comes another bunch of numbers and then you can compare that. Lots of statistics can be made up on the spot. I like that. And you can use statistics to prove anything. I am the best selling computer manufacturer in this particular subsegment. Well, if you are Apple, you look at the top volume market for desktops or portable computers. You know what? There's nobody else playing in that market anyway. If you're IBM or Sun, you say, right, we are the biggest in mainframes or mid-range. Doesn't matter. I can just have to choose my field correctly. And you can use statistics to prove really anything, depending on what you want. How many people here have criticized the Gartner reports for being wrong? Right. Okay. That's very few hands going up. How many people have not criticized them? All right. Bad audience. The challenge is in understanding the data. Not all data is the same. Sometimes data is useful, sometimes it's not. At times the data is sheer garbage. Really, what do you want the data to tell you? It will tell you. It's just numbers after all, right? You put it in one way, it shows you something, it gives you something else. If I give you a number that says 10.1.1.1, most people here will say it's an IP address. As far as I'm concerned, it's just a string. Doesn't have to mean anything. Data can represent a whole bunch of stuff. And usually, most in my experience, that most people give really bad data simply because they don't know how to collect data in the first place. Representing the data is the next challenge. Okay, so how many people here have actually benchmark systems? Show of hands. Okay, how many people here are familiar with this thing called the theory of constraints? Oh, good. A few. So the theory of constraints basically has this thing that says that your system has going to have one bottleneck. At any point of time, you're going to have one bottleneck. And the throughput of that entire system is going to be limited by that one bottleneck bit. So if you are benchmarking a database server which is going to do a lot of inserts and updates and OLTP type system, you're most likely going to be limited by your disk input output. If you're doing mail, I guarantee you it's disk, unless you're doing lots of anti-spam and antivirus content type filtering. Usually that's true on the outbounds, not on the inbounds, if you have them separate. But on a web server, it's most likely to be either memory or CPU. Now, a lot of us know all this stuff from intuition, but we don't have the numbers to back them up. Well, because you never needed to actually be able to prove that this was always going to be the constraint. So when you have people without that intuition who do benchmarks, it can lead to some interesting problems. I had a colleague of mine who was tasked with running a benchmark for a mail server. We are looking at Postfix. So this guy goes, sets up a box, one disk, one slow IDE disk, and starts pumping mail through it. Well, disk maxes out. He doesn't notice it. He simply keeps on increasing it until CPU maxes out. Because till now, he's only seen anything that only when the system cannot accept any more mail is that system going to die out. Well, at that point, he generates a bunch of numbers, some 20,000 odd records. And then we basically goes and says, look, we have spent, the system is spending somewhere between 50% to 70% of its time in context switching. Right. The fact that IO wait is somewhere around 80% of your CPU time is spent in waiting on disk IO was missed out completely. So Postfix is a bad choice for a mail server. Why? Because it's too CPU intensive. You know what? Multiprocessing sucks. You're doing too much context switching. Right. Representing data, he basically didn't show a graph. He didn't show mail queue statistics. He didn't show disk IO statistics. Nothing. Just this much CPU, I was able to send this much mail at this time as a table. It's kind of difficult to read anything from that. So if you have experience as a mail systems person, you will know that this bunch of data is not worth looking at because you've already maxed out the system. How many people here have read Edward Tufte's books? No? Okay, one, two. Oh, good. Edward Tufte's books are pretty much the authoritative reference as far as I'm concerned. If somebody knows better ones, let me know, please. But he's also got this thing against PowerPoint. It's a very small monograph, and it tells you why PowerPoint was responsible for the Challenger disaster. Major correlation. The logic basically was that the representation in PowerPoint of slides removed all the important engineering details. So the people who were doing the evaluation for the Challenger bit, whether to launch or not, had no idea that they were not being given data. They had stuff that looked like what was data. Turns out it wasn't. Charts are useful. Line graphs, bar graphs, you go to a spreadsheet and it'll show you, oh, here's this dozen types of charts that you can do. How do you know which one is appropriate? You have to figure out what question you're asking. Asking the right questions is difficult. Are you looking at saying that this is a performance curve? Are you looking at trying to say, is this, I want to basically look at a distribution of this system? What am I looking at in the first place? If you're looking for distributions, go with your standard, scatter plots. If you're doing a regular benchmark curve, just do a line graph. It's the easiest way. You might even want to go beyond what the spreadsheet does. You need maps, heat maps, or even pie charts, whatever. You need to figure it out. And sometimes, just sometimes, you just need a table because you have got only 5 or 6 rows. Benchmarks, you want a comparison, basically. I want to say that this is my baseline. That's all that I want to do with it. I want to say this is a number. Benchmarks reduce complex sets of numbers into something that says this is one number. How many people here do multi-valued benchmarks anyway? Anyone? One, two. What sort of multi-valued benchmarks do you guys do? Yeah, what?
I was trying to work out how many jobs I could get through a given system and how much heat I'd get produced, so I could work out how many machines I could fit into my data center.
Right. But that was still a fairly related set of numbers, right? As opposed to saying, when I'm looking for the best set of things, and I don't know what the bottleneck of the system is, what am I going to max out? Am I going to look at disk? Am I going to look at CPU stuff? You have questions, sir?
In terms of the special effect example, there's a very clear link between the two numbers. Increase one, the other decreases, and vice versa. Well, there's a link. There's a very clear causal link.
Yeah, I'm sorry?
In terms of the benchmarking heat versus jobs. But the one that most people do is dollars versus something.
Dollars versus throughput.
So dollars for throughput, dollars for servers.
Yeah. Well, ideally, you would normally do dollars per unit of throughput. Because at the end of the day, if you're not figuring out how much throughput you're getting, your numbers are junk. It doesn't matter you don't want to measure disk IOPS. I want to know how many useful database queries I can run with this particular disk subsystem. Or maybe how much mail I can send through this particular type of box. And of course, you don't want to say, I'm going to test this on a home-built PC and then throw a big production SAN for the mail queue. Two different sets of hardware, two different sets of benchmarks. We really don't want benchmarks for when we are deciding this stuff. We want to be able to make trade-offs saying, this is the amount of dollars I have, or whatever some unit of value that you choose, usually dollars, and say, right, I want to get this much throughput, what is it going to cost me? Or I have this much dollars, what is the best I can get out of it? I don't want to spend time running benchmarks that give me anything other than that information. So I may want to say, okay, I'm going to start running a test. First, I'm going to figure out the system bottleneck, and then I'm going to say, right, so I'm going to block on CPU for this much, I'm going to block on DNS for this, or I'm going to block on latency for this. Oh, and latency can be a very, very significant thing for DNS. We were launching this new DNS product. It's just being alpha soft launch right now. So the guy starts by testing it on his on a loopback interface. He gets 33,000 QPS. Tests it from another host, 300 QPS. Go look at the subsystem, go look at the box. Oh, there's no problem there. How much parallelism are you doing? I'm doing one query at a time. Right. Increased parallelism, he gets 33,000 QPS again. Big deal. You just want to know what you're doing and what your limits are. Constraints when you're running your own benchmarks. Okay, yeah, I just covered this. And your data structures and algorithms. That's an interesting one. Because you can end up with saying that, I'm using up 100% of my CPU because I'm basically running this bad data structure here for this particular use case. This is one of those rules of thumb that I generally want to look at. You take a benchmark, look at the result, it's going to be a curve like this. It's a standard curve, 1 minus e raised to minus x type. If it doesn't match it, you're most likely doing something wrong. Your system is going to basically ramp up slow when you're not bottlenecked. Then you hit the bottleneck, and as your bottleneck's utilization increases, the curve becomes flatter and slightly shallower, and then it drops, an inverted bathtub. You really don't want to get to the end of it. Benchmarking tools, yada, you guys know. So questions, discussion, right. You have a question.
One of the, in the consumer arena, one of the common uses of benchmarks is for in PC video card comparisons. Quite famously a while ago, one of the video card manufacturers optimized their code to run the benchmark a little bit faster than the opposition. Do you think that's a legitimate approach for that manufacturer?
Well, from that manufacturer's point of view, it makes sense. From your point of view, it doesn't. The point of any if you're going to run a benchmark, run it using your application. Do not even bother about saying what the standard benchmarks say. That goes in the lies and damn lies and statistics section. That's why the whole thing is there. It doesn't really matter as to what the manufacturer's numbers say. You can't ever trust them. Because, you know what, I'm not running that video card alone. If you could take that video card, figure out that, you know what, I can build a motherboard which will take a really, really slow ARM CPU that normally works in my mobile phone, put it on that thing, give it maybe 64 kilobytes of RAM, and then see what happens to that system. Doesn't work. Well, you could build a board like that if you wanted to, and then say, right, but this system is too slow. You're looking at a system, not at an individual component ever.
Just an example of a benchmark. The mayor of Brisbane some time ago, Clem Jones, needed to have testing done for tractors, earth clearing equipment. So he asked them all to show up at a particular place on a Saturday and had them clear what is now the QE2 stadium, and then said, thank you for your benchmarks. And basically he had the work done. He didn't need to buy anything.
That's a good way of doing it. It's done for free as well. Yeah, but not all of us are that lucky. We can't get real work done that way. Though I do know a bunch of ISPs who do that. Yeah. Hey, you just put up a 400 router order and every router manufacturer is going to be salivating at it. And obviously you want it proved in production, so it has to be tested for at least a year. Well, given that purchase cycles are in the 2 or 3 year cycle there, 1 year of testing is not a very big deal for these guys. 1 year from this guy, 1 year from this guy, 1 year from this guy, 1 year from somebody else. Hey, 4 years worth of free equipment, including service. And of course, there's no cost attached, right? You're only evaluating the product. And the only way you can evaluate it is by testing it in production. More questions? Okay, there's a question this side, Simon.
I actually have a couple of comments rather than questions. Firstly, are you aware of Neil Gunther's work on performance management and measurement?
I'm sorry?
Neil Gunther's work?
No, I have not seen.
He's about the lead guru on performance management, and he generated a universal system performance curve law, which explains that drop off at the end as well.
I read his book.
Yeah, right. Really good.
Yeah.
The second comment is most of my benchmarking is to do with determining whether some change in a code base actually produces a performance change or not. And for that, the normal curves aren't sufficient. You actually have to do fairly sophisticated statistical tests like student T or chi squared, depending on the problem. And this is really a plea to all the people out here. Stop telling me that the performance differences are down in the noise unless you've done the test.
Oh, yes. And if you're ever looking at running a benchmark of your own, remember to include statistical error there. It's worth spending some time learning statistics. There's a bunch of books out there. There's a bunch of tools. The R language is designed for that sort of analysis. It's got enough functions and it's got a lot of stuff built in that makes things easy for you. Pick up a bunch of books. You'll need maybe about 2 books like that. And just go forward. It's extremely easy. R does all the graphing for you. It does all your analysis, but you have to know what analysis to do. You can't just throw numbers. To pull another random example of bad benchmarks out, especially in marketing terms, you have these cameras, point and clicks, where at one point everything was basically megapixels, right? We have got 4 megapixels, we have got 8 megapixels. Bigger is always better, right? Except that at some point or the other, you have to say, this system really, you know, it's got a lot of megapixels and it's so noisy, the photographs produced a crap. And that is the one thing that you can't measure, because photographic quality output, you can't measure that easily. So you basically say, right, I got a more megapixels. And nowadays, then in the middle, it becomes a zoom ratio. 5x, 10x zoom, right? 10x when it extends from 10 mm to 100 mm is not a big deal. Well, it's reasonable, but it's not really a big deal. But on the other hand, a 4x zoom could just as be from 18 to 70 or from 400 to 1600. I've got both lenses. Both of them are 4x. But 70mm to 1600mm is a lot of difference. So yeah, you need to be extremely careful when looking at those marketing numbers. How many people here look at watch toothpaste ads? Bad benchmarks again. So many percent of dentists recommend this. This particular dental association recommends this. Hey, feel free to pay me. I'll recommend it as well. What numbers do you want to buy today? As I said. All right. Any more questions? Comments?
Okay. I think we need to start wrapping it up now. There's about 10 minutes before the next speaker, if anyone wants to change room. And join me in thanking the speaker.